peace in this world. Thank you. Wassalam.
And our next speaker is Dr. Sebastian Paul. He is the MP, that's the Member of Parliament, Ernakulam. He is a distinguished parliamentarian and has been working for social justice and also for the development of all segments of the society. In his career, he has got the public appreciation for taking steps to uproot the social imbalances. Also, he has been trying to sort out the needs of the backward classes of the society. Mr. Sebastian Paul.
Dear friends, I am very happy to be here this evening along with you to extend our salutations to the revered and beloved Huzoor, who is heading the Ahmadiyya Muslim community throughout the world. We just heard that this is a community, a universal Islamic group spread across the globe in 193 countries. But there may be some vital differences or distinction or differences of opinion rather on theology or based on the teachings of the Holy Quran. And I am not competent to go into that controversies or differences of opinion. But being a non-Muslim, my authority is the Holy Quran. And the Holy Quran, according to me, or we all know, it preaches love, mercy, and compassion. Allah is always described with these qualities. But we are living in a very strange and difficult times. We know throughout the world, the present situation is to view with suspicion or to a degree with hatred, the Muslim brethren. And a new philosophy is propounded in the United States, that is the clash of civilizations. One civilization symbolizing or representing the Muslim community, whatever denomination, and the other I need not say. But this is a very, very difficult and painful time. How we can save this situation? How we can restore normalcy and peace in this world? It is a question, a fundamental question, basic question that we all must unitedly address. An answer to that question is badly needed, and that is the need of the hour. And I know that Muslim communities like this, the Ahmadiyya group, an enlightened group, I understand this in that way, an enlightened and sophisticated and educated face of the Muslim community. It is your duty bound to spread the message of love, mercy, and compassion throughout the world, and to present Islam in a different way, in its true manner, true color, so that we can cultivate tolerance, we can cultivate understanding, and only through that exercise, we can restore the spirit of universal brotherhood in this world. In India, as Your Excellency knows, we are passing through very difficult times. India is a significant country as far as the Muslim community, the total population is concerned. The second largest Muslim population in the world is here. At the same time, we are a secular country. We know the importance of tolerance. We know the importance of mutual respect, harmony, religious harmony. But at the same time, we are passing through very great difficulties, a period of difficulty. The trauma of that Mumbai attack is still fresh in our mind. And we are trying to reinvent ourselves as a true secular society, secular country. And in that effort, we need the assistance, help, and cooperation of all minorities, all religious groups. And in this context, I hope and believe that the visit of your excellency will add a great vigor and a new spirit in our endeavor to become a truly secular society where all religions will be tolerated and respected, and a system of governance based on social justice will prevail. In our earnest and strenuous effort to achieve that cherished goal, I hope the message spread by Your Excellency will be of great benefit to us. And in that context, I once again welcome the revered Huzoor to this great city of Cochin, which incidentally I am representing this constituency in Parliament. And on behalf of all the people of this great city, I extend a most cordial welcome to the respected Huzoor. Thank you.
And our next speaker is Professor M.K. Sanu. Professor M.K. Sanu is a prominent personality of socio-cultural literary field of India. His major contributions are in the field of presentation of epic stories, high end of literary deliberations. Mr. M.K. Sanu.
ഇവിടെ ഉപയോഗിക്കേണ്ട ശൈലി എനിക്ക് അപരിചിതമാണ്. ഹുസൂർ ഈ വിശുദ്ധമായ അന്തരീക്ഷത്തിൽ വന്നു ചേർന്നിരിക്കുന്നതിൽ കൊച്ചിയിലെ പൗരാവലിയോടൊപ്പം ഞാനും അഭിമാനം കൊള്ളുകയും അദ്ദേഹത്തിൻ്റെ മുമ്പാകെ എൻ്റെ നമസ്കാരങ്ങൾ അർപ്പിക്കുകയും ചെയ്യുന്നു. ഇത് ഞാൻ മനസ്സിലാക്കിയിടത്തോളം വളരെ വിശുദ്ധമായ ഒരന്തരീക്ഷമാണ്. മാനവരാശി എക്കാലത്തും സ്വപ്നം കണ്ടുപോകുന്ന രണ്ടാദർശങ്ങൾ, സ്നേഹം, സാഹോദര്യം എന്നിവ പ്രചരിപ്പിക്കുന്നതിനും സാക്ഷാത്കരിക്കുന്നതിനും അവിരാമമായി പ്രയത്നിച്ചു പോരുന്ന ഒന്നാണ് അഹമ്മദിയ പ്രസ്ഥാനം. ജിഹാദ് എന്ന പദത്തിന് തന്നെയും ഈ പ്രസ്ഥാനം നൽകുന്ന അർത്ഥം സാധാരണയിൽ നിന്ന് വിഭിന്നമായ ഒന്നാണ്. നമ്മുടെ അന്തരംഗത്തിൽ പ്രവർത്തിക്കുന്ന തിന്മയും വെറുപ്പും അതിനോട് നടക്കുന്ന സമരമാണ് ജിഹാദ് എന്ന പദമായി ഇവർ വ്യാഖ്യാനിക്കുന്നത്. ആ വ്യാഖ്യാനം എല്ലാ മതങ്ങളിലുമുള്ളതാണ്. നമ്മുടെ അന്തരംഗങ്ങളിൽ എന്നും കാലുഷ്യം സൃഷ്ടിക്കുന്ന തിന്മയുടെ മേൽ ആധിപത്യം സ്ഥാപിച്ച് നന്മയുള്ളവരായി മാറുക എന്നതാണ് മനുഷ്യരാശിയുടെ ലക്ഷ്യം. അതാണ് മനുഷ്യൻ ദൈവത്തോട് കാണിക്കുന്ന ഏറ്റവും വലിയ ഭക്തി എന്ന വിശ്വാസം എനിക്കുണ്ട്. ആ വിശ്വാസം നാനാവിധമായ പ്രവർത്തനങ്ങളിലൂടെ ആതുര ശുശ്രൂഷ, വിദ്യാഭ്യാസ പ്രവർത്തനം, അതുപോലെ തന്നെ സർവ സമുദായ മൈത്രി, എല്ലാ മതങ്ങളിലും പ്രവാചകന്മാരെ ആദരിക്കുന്ന മനോഭാവം എന്നിവയിലൂടെ അഹമ്മദീയ പ്രസ്ഥാനം ലോകസമാധാനത്തിലും മാനവരാശിയുടെ ഐക്യത്തിനും ഭാവികാലത്ത് ഭൂമിയെ സ്വർഗസദൃശമാക്കുന്നതിനും നിരന്തരം പ്രവർത്തിച്ചുകൊണ്ടിരിക്കുന്നതിൻ്റെ പേരിൽ ആ പ്രസ്ഥാനത്തിൻ്റെ മുമ്പാകെ ഞാൻ എൻ്റെ അഭിവാദനങ്ങൾ അർപ്പിക്കുന്നു. ഒരു എളിയ അനുഭാവി എന്ന നിലയിൽ ആ പ്രസ്ഥാനത്തിന് ലോകത്തിൽ നന്മയും സാഹോദര്യവും സമാധാനവും സൃഷ്ടിക്കാൻ കഴിയട്ടെ എന്ന് പ്രാർത്ഥിക്കുകയും ചെയ്യുന്നു. നിങ്ങൾക്ക് എൻ്റെ നമസ്കാരം.
താങ്ക് യു. ദിസ് സ്പീച്ച് വിൽ ബി ട്രാൻസ്ലേറ്റഡ് ഇൻ ടു ഉർദു ബൈ മൗലവി നാസർ അഹമ്മദ് എച്ച്.
پیارے حضور آج یہاں کوچی میں موجود ہیں، اس لیے میں بہت ہی خوش ہوں. اور جماعت احمدیہ دنیا میں شانتی اور امن پھیلانے کے لیے کام کر رہی ہے. جہاد کے متعلق ان کا یہ تفسیر ہے کہ جہاد کا معنی یہ ہے کہ اپنے اندر پاک تبدیلی پیدا کرنے کے لیے کوشش کرنا. یہ مطلب ہم ہر مذہب میں ہمیں ملتا ہے کہ جہاد کا اصل جہاد اپنے اندر پاک تبدیلیاں پیدا کرنا ہے. इसी तरह तमाम मज़हब में ये भी हमें पाया जाता है कि तमाम इंसानों के साथ नेक सलूक करना है, हर एक को आतर करना है या हर एक को इज़्ज़त देना है। इसलिए दुनिया में शांति और अमन फैलाने वाली इस जमात का मैं एक अकीदतमंद हूँ और मैं तमाम खुशामदीद कहता हूँ और मैं हर तरह से इसकी कामयाबी के लिए दुआगो हूँ।
And I have the great honor to welcome His Holiness Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmad, the Supreme Head of the Worldwide Ahmadiyya Muslim Community and the fifth Khalifa. Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmad served the community in many capacities in Asia and Africa in the field of education and research. He is in the forefront of promoting peace and upholding the dignity of the religion under the divine guidance of Islam. Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmad.
أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah to all the respected and honorable guests. First of all, I would like to thank all the distinguished guests who, with an open heart and kindness, have joined us here today. By doing so, you have fulfilled the humanly bond of friendship and have shown that you hold in high regard the sentiments of others. India is a vast country where people belonging to different castes and religions abide. And for the survival of the nation, it is important to respect the feelings and sentiments of each other. Today, the world consists of people belonging to different religions, and the founders of those religions have all taught their followers to worship the one God and discharge the rites owed to him and his creation. About 1400 years ago, God Almighty sent the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the law revealed to him in the form of the Holy Quran. About this law bearing book, God Almighty has said in the Holy Quran, "Verily, we ourselves have sent down this exhortation, and most surely we will be its guardian." Chapter 15, verse 10. Hence, to this day, the Holy Quran is still in its purest form with no alteration to it. Several Orientalists have also attested to this fact. This book was revealed to the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam 400 years ago, as I have said, and upon reflection over it, we come to know that it comprehends a wide range of subjects, where it confirms the coming of the prophets in various nations. It also verifies their true teachings. It teaches man how to discharge the rights owed to one another, on what condition war is permitted, and to what extent war should be fought. It also informs us about the inventions that are to be expected in the future, that is today's inventions, how trade should be done, and so on, just to name a few. If one observes the Holy Quran critically, its teachings can be summarized into two main areas. One, recognition of our Creator, and secondly, discharge the rights owed to His creation. Even though some critics do not understand some teachings of the Holy Quran or do not believe in them, they do, however, admit to its originality. To understand the Holy Quran properly, one needs determination and purity of heart. Since the advent of Islam, the Holy Quran has been explained to people by the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam himself, who taught it to his companions. Then, after him, other pious people also studied, understood, and explained it to others for decades. We also believe that in every century, God Almighty sent reformers amongst Muslims, and these were responsible for spreading the true teachings and message of Islam to all, be it Muslim or non-Muslim. Some of such reformers came to the Indian subcontinent. Then in 1889, the founder of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community from Qadian in India claimed to be the reformer and the Messiah and Mahdi, who was to appear in the 14th century as prophesied by the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. We Ahmadis, believing in his claim, belong to his community and accept him to be the Masih and Mahdi, who was to unite all people. Both Muslims and non-Muslims under the one God, so that religious differences would be removed from the world, and so that people would start to realize the purpose of their creation as taught by all prophets, and that is discharging the rights owed to their creation and discharge the rights owed to one another. The founder of the Ahmadiyya community, Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad Qadiani, Masih Maud al-Islam, also announced that the purpose of his advent was to strengthen the bond between man and his creator, and secondly, draw man's attention towards discharging the rights owed to God's creation. He taught that man should come closer to his creator by worshipping him, and must discharge the rights owed to one another in order to remove all grievances and religious disputes that arise amongst people. He also mentioned that these were in accordance with the Quranic teachings. Here one should note that God sometimes speaks metaphorically, which becomes difficult for people to comprehend. Therefore, God sends messengers into the world to explain and convey God's message to them, which had been revealed to the prophets in the past. According to our belief, Masih Maud alayhi salam is that special reformer whom God Almighty sent in this age to convey God's message to us. I will now briefly elaborate on what the Holy Quran teaches us regarding the establishment of peace in the society and the discharging of each other's rights. We Ahmadis try to ensure that we always abide by these teachings and share it with others so that the world becomes a haven of peace, love, and harmony. Muslims have been commanded to abstain from evil and adopt virtue and righteousness. To this effect, it is stated in the Holy Quran, "You are the best people raised for the good of mankind. You enjoin good and forbid evil and believe in Allah." Chapter 3, verse 111. Hence, people who believe in the Holy Quran have been advised to show integrity in all their endeavors and work to promote goodness and righteousness within their societies. But before one can counsel others towards such ways, he must practice what he preaches. You cannot counsel others if you do not follow the path of righteousness yourself. If all people who claim to be righteous abide by this principle, then their counsel would be effective. They would be considered valued members of the society. Others would respect them, give importance to what they say, and obey them since they understand that this person is adopting such an approach not for his own good, but with the welfare of others at heart. He exercises extreme justice in his dealings, and when enjoining others to abstain from evil and adopt virtue, he also respects this, he also expects this from his dear ones. How to establish justice and promote peace, love, and brotherhood in the society? The Holy Quran says, "And when you speak, observe justice, even if the person concerned be a relative, and fulfill the covenant of Allah." Chapter 6, verse 153. Justice requires that even if you have to give evidence against your dear ones, then do so. Today, when we take a closer look around us, we observe that most of the disputes and causes of dissension amongst people is due to not observing proper justice. We only think of our vested interests or that of our dear ones without considering the fact that the other might be hurt by our actions. And once grievances develop, it becomes difficult to eliminate them. In terms of international relations, the level of justice we are expected to show is commanded by the following words in the Holy Quran: "O ye who believe, be steadfast in the cause of Allah, bearing witness in equity, and let not a people's enmity incite you to act otherwise than with justice. Be always just, that is nearer to righteousness, and fear Allah, surely Allah is aware of what you do." Chapter 5, verse 9. This is the high standard for establishing justice in the society. To remove all enmities and dissension from the world, we have to show justice to such an extent that a people's enmity should not cause us to act otherwise than with justice. When God Almighty has said that, He is all-knowing and all-hearing. Then for the person with the fear of God in his heart, this is a grave matter. Because one can pull the wool over someone's eyes, but cannot deceive God. You can go against your agreements with people and deceive them, but God knows what is apparent and what is hidden in our hearts. So we cannot act cleverly before Him. God Almighty has commanded us to always behave justly, keeping the fear of Allah in mind, and discharge the rights owed to one another with the fear of God in one's heart. When you make agreements with your enemies, do so with purity of hearts and with the intention of establishing justice in the world. And one who believes in God should remember that God is watchful over all that one does. This beautiful teaching helps us in removing all enmities from the society. I will now give an example how the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam practiced justice in his everyday life. It is narrated that once a Jew came before the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam with the complaint that a companion of the Holy Prophet had failed to return the 4 dirham, the money of that time, he owed the Jew. And the time for settlement had exceeded. The Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam called the companion and asked him whether that was the case, to which the companion answered in the affirmative. The Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam asked him to return the money, to which the companion said he had no money at present and would return it as soon as he had it. The Holy Prophet again said, "Return the money." The companion again replied, "He didn't have it." This went on for 3 times, after which the companion was forced by the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam to repay the money. He then went to the market, sold the clothes he was wearing for 4 dirhams, placed his headdress over his body, and returned the money to the Jew. This is how the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam guided his followers to fulfill their agreements and show justice so that the peace and harmony could prevail in the society. This Quranic teaching and the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's action has shown Muslims the right path to follow. Today, opponents of Islam criticize it for using force and say that it is extremist in nature. However, this allegation is totally unfounded. Islam is a religion of peace, love, and harmony. In its history, if ever wars were fought, then they were because they had been initiated by the enemies. Even in such wars, the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam always expected justice to be carried out. He always ordered his companions that no child, no woman, old or weak, was to be harmed. No religious leader belonging to any religion, living peacefully in his house of worship, was to be hurt. Even trees were not to be felled in enmity. Wars were only between one army and the other. What more beautiful and virtuous action like this shown by the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam can you expect from someone? In comparison, when you look at wars fought today, it is the innocent civilians and inhabitants of cities and towns that are affected. It is the innocent and weak members of the society who come under the fire of this cruel bombardment. Islam never teaches such cruelty. Alas, today this beautiful teaching is being ignored and misconstrued by some Muslim groups, consequently defaming the name of Islam. In this day and age, we believe in the Imam of the age, Mahdi and Messiah, who taught us that under the prevailing circumstances, jihad must be with the pen by reforming yourself and by spreading the message of peace, not the sword. Jihad of the sword is now not permitted. We must only concentrate on drawing people towards Islam's beautiful teachings. The founder of the community was then succeeded by the institution of Khilafah, which has been established to continue the work of representing Islam's true teachings and ensuring people are guided towards the right path through reformation and moral training. According to our belief, based on Quranic teachings, there is no compulsion in religion. Everyone is free to profess the religion of his choice, but one does not have the right to degrade other religions or their founders. This is against the teachings of the Holy Quran. We have been commanded to respect the feelings of others and draw man towards the worship of his creator so as to spread peace, love, and harmony in the society. Today, quite a number of people is in the selfish pursuit of seeking fulfillment of one's vested interests without giving a thought to discharging the rights due to others. And if we do not recognize our Creator and discharge the due rights to one another, the world will lead to terrible disaster whose effects will be seen for years to come, and the future generation will blame us for this. It is my fervent prayer that we safeguard ourselves and our generation from such destruction. Once again, I thank you all for having listened to me patiently. May Allah bless you all. Thank you.
We bow down our heads in heartfelt thanksgiving to Almighty Allah, who has enabled us to organize this assembly of love and human brotherhood. Hence, it is with greatest humility that we extend our most hearty thanks to all who have attended this gathering from prominent socio-political as well as media circles of Kerala. Thank you. Before we conclude, let's have a silent prayer led by Honorable Huzoor. May God strengthen his hands.
So now we shall offer silent prayer. Ahmadis will follow me in there. Others are free to offer their prayer according to their own way, if they wish. Please. Wow. Amen. Yes.
Thank you. What do you have? What do you have?